Well, welcome everyone. Join me in welcoming Werner Herzog to the Coolidge Corner. So always the professor, I come prepared with notes and books. This is an unusual format and venue for me because Werner and I have known each other a long time and we talk casually as friends, and I don't think we've ever had a conversation in front of so many people before. But I wanted to start out, if I could, with an anecdote. The first time I met Werner, I was actually, after a venue somewhat like this. I was a member of the audience. It was 30 years ago. It was London at the National Film Theatre, and Werner was introducing and then doing a Q&A with the audience after a premiere screening of the last film he made with Klaus Kinski, Corpo Verde. And a question came from the audience from a particularly truculent person about exploiting the natives and Fitzcarraldo and all this. And Werner, you know, with a very, very calm voice said, look, let's just get this straight. He said the people who worked on the film made 2 to 3 to 4 times more than they would have made per day if they were working on for the lumber company or the mining companies. I helped the indigenous people get title to their land and so forth. And then without changing his voice, he stood up in the same calm tone, said, and look, anybody who wants to say anything about me exploiting the natives or anybody else should step outside right now behind the theater and let's settle this once and for all. And an audience of 600 plus people, they were stunned. Nobody moved. But that moment endeared him to me forever. I knew he was the man that I always imagined him to be. I'm going to put a series of questions. You'll have to sort of live vicariously through my questions. And the first thing I wanted to ask or talk about with Werner is in 2009, Time magazine named you one of the most influential people in the world in the category of entertainers. And it's quite a remarkable thing, really, when people like Jay Leno were in there, Tom Hanks. And I remember you saying, we spoke about it, and you said, I think it was at the rap party for My Son, What Have You Done, and you said, well, very modestly, you said, I don't think it's so much because of any of the films I've made so much as the way I've made them. I think, of course, it has to do as much with the films you've made as the way you made them, but maybe talk a little bit about that, if you would. What you kind of mean?
It was an odd thing that Time magazine approached me and they said, could I come to the ceremony of the 100 most influential people on the planet? And I said, I do not want to be in this list. And they were completely stunned because nobody would refuse it, and I said, can I refuse? They said, no, it's our choice, whether you like it or not. And then the person on the other end of the phone asked me, to which group would you then like to belong? And I said, yes, I can tell you, the 300 Spartans at Thermopylae, under Leonidas, the great heroes, that 300 warriors fighting 300,000 advancing Persian troops. And of course they were wiped out up to one single man who survived, who brought the news to Sparta. And that's where I would like to belong. And so they kind of chuckled and I thought I was joking, but I was not. Anyway, so these are very odd categories, but being lined up among the recipients of the Coolidge Awards, that's a fine lineup, and I think it has real value for me. Other things.
I think you've made films on 7 continents. You're probably the only living filmmaker to have worked on all
seven.
Yeah,
but don't harp on it because I might end up on the Guinness Book of World
Records. I would hide in a dumpster. They're always Bavarian films, no matter where you make them. They always have a Bavarian character, no matter which continent they're on. So you're safe. You know, I once read an essay written by a mountain climber, and it was a wonderful expression, which always reminds me of your films. He said, it's one thing to stand at the bottom of the mountain and sort of dream or fantasize about being at the top, and it's something altogether to drag the whole animal up there too. And your films have that quality. They're so embodied, they're so physical. And I know you've said on many occasions and in different contexts, film must be physical.
Well, it is to some extent, and for example, Into the Inferno, that some of it was quite physical. You had to do some some serious climbing, so you had to do a serious form of traveling into the Damakil Depression in Ethiopia, something like 350 feet below sea level in the hottest place on God's wide earth. So yes, a physical side of it, but not always. Like I have to point out, for example, the film on the internet, Lo and Behold. Of course, it's all conceptual. Okay. It's concepts. It's things that have to do with our way, how we are communicating and interacting now in the world of the 21st century. Of course, there's not not much physical there, and it has to do with concepts. And it's strange because I always felt I, who hardly uses the internet, and I, who do not even have a cell phone, I do not want it for cultural reasons, I will make the only real competent film on the internet. And, yeah, you find it funny, but it is. Where is the other film that's really competent about the internet? Nowhere. There are films that will tell you, yeah, that Facebook in the beginning had 2,000 followers, and then a year later it was 20 million, so what? And then it was 5 years later, 2 billion. Yes, okay, you can quantify things, and it doesn't give you any insight about the solitudes on Facebook. It doesn't tell you any of that. So, some of it is experiences are non-physical. Mm-hmm. And I do remember that back in the 80s, I spoke about the new creations of tools of communication. At that time, it was not just radio and television and telephone. And at that time, the first cell phone companies came up and made people much more connected from your car or from anywhere. And at that time, I said, it may sound paradoxical, but with the explosive increase of tools of communications, our solitudes will increase. And I said, in 20 years we have the year 2000, a new millennium coming, and the next century is probably going to be the century of solitudes. And I think when I look around, yes, it is occurring. The solitudes, and it sounds paradoxical, but it is not. Of course, you are connected when you are caught in a snowdrift close to the Canadian border, and nobody around, and you have a cell phone. You still can call for help, and they will find you. They will locate you. But that is only a technical side. The much deeper side of it is the solitudes. The existential solitudes, and it has nothing to do with anything physical. It is just because I'm somebody who experiences the world in a very intense, very raw, very profound and direct way, meaning that I travel on foot, meaning that I read, like you, we are people who are reading.
I have a reader question for you in a moment. But I'm going to drag you back to the physical, if I may, the metaphysical. You know, just apropos of what you were saying, something has always struck me is that some of your most physical films, or films like about an athlete, like Steiner, is also to me one of your most spiritual or metaphysical films in a way. And your essay on the sublime that you published in Orion, that's the film you talk about, an essay on the sublime, a film about an athlete, and A Wheel of Time, about the Chalakra ceremony, which you augmented with the pilgrimage around Mount Kailash, it's a film about Buddhism, but it's a very physical film. And what I remember so vividly is that monk that prostrates himself for thousands of kilometers, the physicality the physicality of the praying, almost doing like marine push-ups, up and down and up and down, and then Bells from the Deep, your film about faith and superstition and